Metals are sprayed into a flame with an atomizer. This is strontium. This is barium. This is sodium. This is potassium. This is lithium. This is copper.
If we pour methanol onto sodium chloride and ignite it, the flame produced is yellow in color. If instead of using sodium chloride, we use boric acid, a compound made of boron, hydrogen, and oxygen, the flame produced is green in color. Each salt imparts a characteristic color. The emission of light by heated or burning objects provide important clues to our understanding of atoms.
You probably know that light is made up of different colors, and that sunlight contains the full spectrum of visible light. But did you also know that when each type of element burns, the light it gives off has its own unique spectrum? We can see this by looking through this, a diffraction grating, which is a type of spectroscope, like this one. And when you look through a scope at a burning element, a bright line spectrum appears, which you can think of as the element's fingerprint. Take a look. See what sodium chloride, just plain table salt, does? Okay, now let's look at it through the spectroscope. Now, here are some elements for you to identify.
When the video stops, compare the bright line spectrum shown here to the ones printed in your chemistry text. Here's your second unknown. And how about this one? And now for my favorite element. What's creating this purple flame?
Tonight I'm going to try to figure out what some of the stars are made out of. You think it'll work?
High voltage is applied to an element in the gas phase. The element emits light. Using a prism, we can split the light into its component colors. Every element emits a distinct set of colors unique to that element.
Stumble in and bumped your head. If not for me, then you'd be dead. I picked you up, put you back on solid ground. If I go crazy, then will you still call me Superman? If I'm alive and well, will you be there holding my hand? I'll keep you by my side with my superhuman might, kryptonite.
Whether it's part of a towering Broadway billboard or just a simple sign, neon lights are all made basically the same way and have been for over 80 years. Neon is really a generic name for any luminous tube that uses one of the inert or noble gases to create its glow. Usually argon or neon, or a combination of both, are the gases of choice. As we'll soon see, the inert nature of these elements makes them ideal for this purpose. The neon light is a cousin of man's oldest electrical acquaintance, lightning. Both illustrate a simple fact. Light is given off whenever electricity passes through a gas. For some elements, this light often has a uniquely characteristic color. Argon emits a pale lavender glow, while neon itself gives off a bright red light. Creating neon signs begins with glass tubing that's heated and bent into a pattern. The blowing is to ensure that the walls of the hot glass don't collapse before they cool. An electrode is attached to each end of the tube with a heat seal so there won't be any gas leaks later on. The tube is then attached to a vacuum pump, which will draw almost all the air out, creating a partial vacuum. Why do you think it's necessary to create a vacuum? The partial vacuum in a neon tube makes it possible to produce a steady glow with very little power and very little heat produced. That's why neon lights are more efficient than incandescent bulbs. Before the gas goes in, the tube is bombarded with heat to remove any impurities that might remain inside or on the electrodes. This may give you a clue about why inert gases work best in a luminous tube. It's because they aren't likely to react with anything inside. What do you think would happen if you used common gases like oxygen or carbon dioxide? Now it's time to pump in the gas, seal off the tube, and watch the energy of electricity transformed into color. Let's look just a little closer and see how this happens. As an atom becomes excited, its electrons absorb energy and jump to higher energy orbitals. When electricity is applied continuously, the electrons absorb the energy, jump to higher orbitals, emit the excess energy, and return to the lower energy orbitals. The excess energy is emitted as a photon. If the photon's frequency is in the visible range of the electromagnetic spectrum, what we see is color, the bright line spectrum of that particular element. But the only elements we've heard about so far are neon and argon, and we've seen a lot more than two colors. Today's neon signs feature just about every shade of the rainbow, but they don't use dozens of different gases. Through some modern sleight of hand, clear glass can now be coated with fluorescent phosphors to create almost any color, and special tubes have been developed that filter out all colors but the desired one. Another trick is adding liquid mercury to intensify colors. Once the tube is heated, mercury vapor forms, and the inert gas inside acts as a carrier.
You know how everybody's always asking you what you want to do when you get out of school? Well, if your last name is Grucci, you don't have much choice.
I was born into this business. My grandfather's grandfather started the business back in 1850. And it's something that automatically gets in your blood after you go on your first program and you realize what's going on and you realize that the audience really are there to watch what you're doing or what your family is doing. After that, the rush is unequaled and you're looking for the next one and the next one and the next one.
Phil Grucci is the fourth generation Grucci to make, manufacture, and master the art of pyrotechnical perfection. Because of the sheer nature of the business, you'd expect safety to be key, but even the factory is designed to minimize chain reactions in case of an accident. Several small buildings are separated by sand piles because the metals used in making fireworks can be so combustible in combination that contact with even a spark can cause an explosion. And please, no smoking. The first family of fireworks is responsible for some of the most fantastic pyrotechnics in the world, like George Bush's presidential inauguration and the 4th of July in New York City.
We use chemistry in our business primarily to create the effect, to create the pyrotechnic effect, to regulate burn times and create colors and sizes and movement in the pyrotechnics. The gorgeous colors that you see on any one of our given programs are created by the utilization of many metals, many elements, to create different colors. We have the coppers to create the blues. We have the bariums to create the greens. We have the strontiums to create the reds. and the salts primarily create your yellows.
Now, great-grandpa Grucci kept comet combinations and recipes for Roman candles in a shoebox. Well, today, testing starts in the lab. Samples of metals, chemicals, and oxidizers are all combined to find the perfect effect. And a homogeneous mix is as important as the match.
I can compare that to a milkshake. You have a strawberry milkshake, and you drink the milk on the top and then get to the strawberries on the bottom. It's not as good as if it's blended throughout. When we decide which color we want to use, we also need to make a choice of various oxidizers and fuels to create those colors. One of the main oxidizers that we use is potassium perchlorate or potassium nitrate. And the reason why they're called oxidizers is because when heated up and when ignited, it creates its own oxygen. It creates its own oxygen so the item can burn and perform on its own without the atmosphere taking effect. For a binder or glue, we use dextrin in the formula. Wood pulp is used as a flame propagator. Red gum also uses a flame propagator. Charcoal we use to manufacture black powder, which is also a fuel. Antimony trisulfide for the gold glitter effect. Combination of magnesium and aluminum for a white flame, a fuel also. Aluminum and titanium in different flake sizes also for the flitter. A very large flake, a flat flake of titanium will give you a very white twinkle, but a strobing type twinkle. Whereas a fine powder such as a magnesium or aluminum will burn very quickly because it's the surface area that is exposed is more so, and it burns quickly and it gives a white photo flash look. Sound is dictated by the packaging. If you've ever blown into a tube really, really hard, passed air through the top of a tube, it makes a whistling noise. Pyrotechnically, we're passing a flame quickly through a tube, and it's doing the same thing. It's creating a whistling noise.
Fireworks is one business where timing is everything, specifically the timing fuse. Using potassium nitrate and special packaging, the Grucci's can determine how long it will take for the fuse to ignite the aerial shell. But what's behind the bang?
A whole host of components such as your serpents, which are the swimming items that you see in the sky, bombs, which are reporting devices, cross-set comets, stars, which are the color-producing items. When we take all of these chemicals together and make a color-producing device, such as a star, all of this placed together into a cardboard case gets wrapped with wet paper that has glue in it. And when the paper dries, it becomes hard, making a projectile. The projectile is then finished to create such an item as large as this. This is one of the bigger ones. This shell will go about 1,200 feet in the air before it explodes.
Once a shell explodes, everything that was packed inside is ignited.
When all the components ignite, it creates enough gas to rupture this case and at the same time explode or emit all of the effects, whether they be colored stars, whether they be the serpents, whether they're the comets, depending on the effect that we're trying to create in the sky. This is basically the payload to get it up into the air, and then the gases and all the flame takes ignition and the effect is produced. There's a number of elements that go into designing a program.
Weeks of planning go into the CW Post University homecoming show. Setup takes a full day, and crew members make sure shells are loaded absolutely right. Safety here is key, too. They set distances to the audience, gauge the wind and the weather, and most importantly, keep a fire extinguisher handy. During the show, everybody knows the drill, the program, and their position. And the best part, they get paid for it.
Some of the shells that will be at the CW Post project are strobe shells, ring shells, which is a patterned shell in the sky that forms a perfect ring, star shells, color and serpent shells, which are the small squiggly items and the movement items that are in the sky. There'll be plenty of salutes, which are the reporting devices used during the finale of the program. we look at the entire array of pyrotechnics when we go on a program like that and try to give the audience a little taste of everything that we have in stock. Professional fun, but you really enjoy that excitement of being there and having control of those pyrotechnics as they're going off. And the best part of the program is obvious at the end when the finale is completed and the audience is going out of their minds for what they've just seen. It's great.